Okay, thank you, and thanks for having me here. It's a wonderful place, and it's nice that so many people gather just to this kind of workshop. What I want to speak about today, so first you can notice that I think it's the first time I managed to make a title which is actually longer than the number of letters of my collaborators, but that's so it's already an exploit. So I want to speak about like this construction we have about the Fleur theory for a pair of Lagrangian cobordism, which now we have been talking about for a while. But instead of explaining the construction of it, I want to use it to show that if you twist the coefficient in this with a fundamental group of the cobordism, you can get information on pi 1 of some cobordism. And so I will state the main theorem I want to prove. So first I will be always in R to n plus 1 and size 0. Like if you want to go to a slightly larger setup, I think you can think of contactization of some Liouville manifold, and then you assume that the Legendre and the manifold we are considering are horizontally displaceable. Basically, I want duality to be true. So that's it. So the goal is to use twisted coefficient in Fleur theory, somehow like what Michael Sullivan or Mihai Damian or other people did, to prove the following two theorems. First theorem, let sigma be an exact Lagrangian cobordism from lambda minus to lambda plus. So did you follow my notation, right? So sigma is a Lagrangian submanifold of the simplectization. At minus infinity, it looks like the cylinder over a Legendrian submanifold lambda minus, and at plus infinity, it looks like a cylinder over a Legendrian submanifold lambda plus, right? And in between, you have something compact. So that's what I will be calling an exact Lagrangian cobordism. And I also assume that the Chekhanov algebra of lambda minus admits an augmentation. And third condition, lambda plus has no repcord of index 0. Then the following is true. If I assume that the ends of the cobordism are simply connected, then the whole cobordism itself is simply connected. Okay. That's okay? So this is the first statement. Maybe one remark. So this is, this condition might be weird, right? So it is a geometric condition on what type of Legendrian submanifold I consider at the top. And what it really implies is that there exists a unique augmentation of the Chekhanov algebra at the top in any ring. And I will explain why this condition is necessary for the proof in any ring. I should not try to write a word I'm not saying because I'm making a mistake. Okay, and second thing, if this condition is removed, then we have example where sigma is not simply connected. I will show that also. So it will look like it's a condition which arises from the way we want to prove the result, but it's also a condition when we remove it, we have a counterexample of the result, right? And the second theorem I want to prove, is it okay for the statement? Yeah. Yeah. Yes. What's your question?
In theorem A, can you, so you have assumption that both ends are simply connected?
Yes. Oh, you want to say that if I assume that both ends have isomorphic pi 1?
Or at least, yeah.
Just one end.
Yeah, so plus lambda plus.
Ah, if I put lambda plus simply connected and lambda minus not simply connected, then also counterexample. There exists Also, example, when pi 1 of lambda minus is, it's actually a good question. Maybe I will take the time to is different than 1. Pi 1 of lambda plus is equal to 1, and pi 1 of sigma is not simply connected, right? So we need both. Actually, okay, if I take the time, I don't know, usually I tend to make digressions, so maybe it's possible it will happen. But I could, yes? In any ring, it means that whatever the ring I'm looking at, there is a unique augmentation in this ring. That's actually the condition I want for the proof. Yeah. It's a problem. It's a common problem to most of the people. But okay, right. Well, the example is easy. Right. The example is the following: you take this Legendrian torus, which is a spin of the trivial Legendrian torus, and I attach a two-handle to it. Then it gives me a cobordism to the witness sphere. The witness sphere is simply connected, and this thing is not simply connected, and the cobordism is. Okay. Yes.
Is
here? No, because even lambda minus and lambda plus might be different. Right.
So it's a purely a consequence on.
So far, okay, yeah, but also, I mean, it would be more something which is in the same flavor of theorem B. But if I assume that lambda plus and lambda minus are actually the same, so Legendrian sum manifold, and that they are homotopy spheres, then I can deduce that. But I mean, the whole thing is that usually to prove this thing, we use edge cobordism theorem or something. Right, and the fact that when you stack cobordism together, you don't have cancellation of handle.
If the cobordism of Lagrangians to Lagrangians is still
is obvious.
No, it's not.
I mean, the one where that the homology is the same is well, it's always true without any. Yeah, I really didn't mention obvious. Okay, and now the second theorem I want to prove is when I assume that lambda, the both end of the cobordism are the same, right? And now I don't have the geometric condition on the top end, but I assume that the augmentation exists over C. Then, if lambda is simply connected, so is sigma, here without any other assumption. So I want to explain how to prove both of those theorems. And both of those theorems use some long exact sequence. Both prove uses some long exact sequence involving Legendrian contact homology, the linearized one, and the Fleur homology of the cobordism, or the Fleur homology of the cobordism relative to its negative end, or any other variant like this, right? And I will explain what I want to use. Yes? Yes. So people are following. Okay. So the first part of my talk will be how to prove theorem I, and the second will be how to prove theorem B. Right. And let's organize. Okay. So the proof of theorem A actually studies the functoriality and the behavior of the fundamental class in Legendrian contact homology under Lagrangian cobordism. And it's some sort of characteristic class argument which I want to explain. So I want to recall what is the fundamental class in Legendrian contact homology. So I think for Legendrian contact homology in Euclidean space or for displaceable Legendrian sum manifold, there are two results which I think are very important and also helped me really to understand what Legendrian contact homology was in this case. And the first one is a theorem of, in dimension one is due to Jos Sabloff, and in higher dimension is due to Ekholm, John, and Josh. It is the following. So for any augmentation of a Legendrian some manifold lambda in R to n plus 1, there exists a long exact sequence. So just not to screw up the degree too much. In vaudeville, the linearized Legendrian contact homology of lambda, the singular homology of the underlying manifold lambda, and the Legendrian contact cohomology of lambda, and then it goes back to Legendrian contact homology. So this is already a first structural result. And the thing which I will be interested in is the following thing. I want to give name this one. Right? And the image of the point, so of the generator of the degree zero homology here, is always non-zero in cohomology. Right? And this class, I will call it C epsilon. And this is what I want to call the fundamental class in Legendrian contact cohomology. Right? Okay, and what's the relation with Lagrangian cobordism? Well, I think the first relation you can see is the second theorem I claim to be important and relevant for the structure of Legendrian contact homology. It is due to Paul Seidel, or in the setting of in the language of Legendrian contact homology, has been written by Ekholm, with a few details missing, and the details have been filled by Yorgos. Is that if L is a Lagrangian submanifold such that its boundary is a given Legendrian submanifold, then L induces an augmentation epsilon L, and you have the following isomorphism. The singular homology of L is isomorphic to the linearized contact cohomology of lambda. And in this situation, so let's call it psi, and psi of the point here is exactly this characteristic classes, the fundamental class. Okay. And indeed, it is non-zero. Okay. Made a mistake? No? And so to prove the first theorem, I want to understanding the fundamental class, not when I have a feeling, but when I have a cobordism. Right? So what we did in this joint work with Giorgos, Paolo, and Roman was when we take a cobordism between two Legendrian submanifold, we make a small perturbation of the cobordism, right? And we define a complex which is generated by chords from the red part to the, is the color different?
It's not,
It's not. This one? No, not better. It's very better or just slightly? It's better, okay. Okay, perfect, thank you. Okay, so by chord from the red to the white on the top, plus intersection point, plus chords from the red to the white on the bottom. Right, and we define a Fleur differential involving all those kind of things, with keeping in mind that we need to use augmentation. Yes.
Oh, it's complex.
Ah, yeah. I think one time I gave a talk in MIT, and you already told me that. Yeah. Okay. It's complex. I mean. There is no E.
What do you mean by chords on top or on bottom?
Okay, so if I take one cobordism, I have rep chords of the Legendrian submanifold, the trajectory of the rep vector field starting on the Legendrian and ending on the same. But now I make a small perturbation of it. So I have two copies here, right, which are like somehow the same, but I look at copies which start from one copy and end on another copy. That's the generator of the complex. Oh, what I mean, top and bottom. Ah, yeah. So, okay, this is a mess now, right? It's like some flexibilization goes up, right? So like it has an up, but it.
Oh, it's different. Oh, okay.
Yeah, maybe I'm going too fast. I'm sorry. Sorry. Okay, and so, and this complex is acyclic.
Sorry.
Lambda minus.
No, sorry.
I got it. Yeah, minus is bottom. And okay, so I'm going very fast, but I will just say.
You have a perturbation,
right? Yeah, move things. Intersection point, okay. Okay. So, and then the differential involves stuff between all those things. So you should think of looking at holomorphic curves which have the asymptotic toward the good object. But you should keep in mind that all of them have also extra negative end toward chords of lambda minus or either pure white or pure red. And those, I evaluate my augmentation, I choose on them, right? So augmentation play the role of bounding cochains in this theory, right? So that whenever I draw something like this, you should think of it as being actually the sum of all things like this. And on this, I evaluate the augmentation to weight the curves. Is it okay? And why did I want to say that? Okay, so then this complex is acyclic. Right? And it is acyclic, but if you look at the shape it has, it is a 3x3 matrices, and it has some differential here, some zero here, some terms here, and here it has minus zero, minus, minus zero, a term here. So what you actually see is a cone of a map, right? You have this complex, you have this complex, and you have this map between those two complex. So it means the fact that it is acyclic, it means that this map is a quasi-isomorphism, right? From the complex here, which I want to call CF minus infinity, of the cobordism, so it involves intersection point and chord at the end to the top.
Sorry,
yes.
Haha.
Well, just because I can move everything, Right. It's just because now that I put everything, like seeing at the bottom, seeing at the top, an intersection point, it is invariant under a very large class of deformation. And the deformation I want to do is just take this red part and moving it very far away. Okay. So, and this is a quasi-isomorphism. That was the acyclicity gives me, right? And so somehow this plays the role of this in Seidel-Ekom-Dimitroglou result theorem, right? So you should think of the complex generated by intersection point and negative record as being the Fleur complex of a virtual feeling which doesn't exist, but I simulate this feeling by using augmentation, right? Which means also that somewhere there, the fundamental class exists. I'm going very too slow. Well, the class of the point exists. Yes, yes, I said that, no? Okay. So where is it? Well, it depends on which perturbation I choose at the negative end. So if I choose this perturbation, am I confusing, very, very confusing? CF in minus infinity is this complex, right? None, like this particular thing, if I have like those terms which are, both of those terms which are non-zero, this is not a complex. The thing generated by intersection point is usually not a complex, right? Because you can have this kind of degeneracy, right? Right? But if I include also negative record, then I have a complex which is virtually the complex of a feeling, right?
And on the right hand side, that should really be the complex for...
Yes. Well, I can argue that the homology is quasi-isomorphic too. Okay? I want to go there. Okay, so how to get the class of the point here to understand what is the fundamental class and how to play with it to prove my theorem. Okay, so if I make the perturbation I claim, so this one, right, I also have something like d0 minus is 0 for energy reason. Yes. Yes. You allow me to.
No, I don't.
Yeah, it is lambda plus. Yeah. for energy reason. And so also this thing is a cone, so you have a long exact sequence, and the long exact sequence involves Legendrian contact homology at the bottom, the Legendrian contact cohomology at the top, and the homology of the cobordism relative to its negative end, right? But here, you don't have the class of the point, right? So it is not the good perturbation. So the perturbation I want to do is instead of pushing this one up, I will push it down, and then I make it going up, and I have the following thing. Right, and this implies that d minus 0 is 0, so I still have a long exact sequence, and the long exact sequence involves Legendrian contact homology on the top. The Legendrian contact, so this is cohomology, here you have homology at the bottom, and now I have really the singular homology of the cobordism. Right, and I will call this map G sigma, right? And the theorem is that G sigma of the point, exactly for the same reason as it was here, is equal to the fundamental class C epsilon plus, right? So I have a way to see the fundamental class so as being something topological, even if I don't have a filling, right? You can play this game with a cylinder. You just take the cylinder, you perturb a little bit the cylinder, you have a class of the point, and this is where is the fundamental class. Okay. Proof of theorem A. Okay, you can play a little bit more with this game, right? And if you glue this type of cylinder to the other type of cylinder, I just say it because I've made this digression so I can make more, right? If I glue the same type of perturbation which was giving me, don't know which exact sequence, whatever, and I stretch the neck, you can see that actually the fundamental class is functorial. So the map induced by the cobordism will map the fundamental class here to the fundamental class here because the point lies here. Okay, whatever. Okay. Okay. So, keeping track. Of the boundary of holomorphic curves. On the red part, right? So if I, every time I see an holomorphic curve, I actually look at what path the red part is doing, right? Allow me to define the complex with coefficients in Z2 pi 1 of sigma. Right? If I use capping path. So every end of chord and every intersection point, I choose a particular capping path to a base point. And now I look at things. Any curves define me a loop. And I can use it to take this to have a pi 1 contribution to every holomorphic curve. And so it means that the whole theory can be lived with coefficient in the group ring of pi 1 of a cobordism. Okay. And the long exact sequence, this one, now I have the Legendrian contact cohomology of lambda, sorry, plus with coefficient in Z2 pi 1 of sigma. But here I have the augmentation epsilon plus tilde. I will explain what this means. And then I'm going to Legendrian contact homology of lambda minus with the augmentation epsilon tensor product with Z2 pi 1 of sigma. Here I use the fact that pi 1 of lambda minus was simply connected, right? Because it can define a theory which is still defined with the augmentation, and all homotopy class of map goes to zero, so it really split as a tensor product, which is not the case so far here, right? And the homology of the universal cover of sigma, right? Where sigma is the universal cover. Okay. So what's the problem here? The problem here is that if I start with an augmentation at the bottom and I lift it as an augmentation on the top, right? Remember that I was doing something on the two copy. Right? So by the way, I twist my coefficient. When I lift things along the white copy, I don't twist the coefficient, right? But when I lift on the red copy, I do twist the coefficient. So even if I start with the same augmentation here, I might end up with two different augmentations here, right? So it might be a bilinearized contact cohomology and not a linearized contact homology, where the characteristic, the fundamental class might be zero. Right. But using the hypothesis I put that there is only one augmentation and that the thing is simply connected, over here I also have the following thing. Right. So here, use hypothesis of the theorem. Right. And now I have this map G sigma tilde, right? And G sigma tilde, for the same reason, well, it's a little play with like explicitly what holomorphic curves are involved. G sigma tilde of the point, if I choose my capping path carefully, will become C epsilon plus tensor 1. But it's also a G equivariant map, right? So it means if I do G times the point, I have this times G, right? But there is only one point in the homology of sigma tilde, right? Because sigma tilde is connected, right? So it means that G is equal to 1 for any G in pi 1 of sigma tilde, okay? So it means that sigma tilde is simply connected. It's okay? Right. I mean, geometrically, what happened? I mean, this might look like a bit of nonsense, but it's just I have something which is simply connected. I have something which I want to be a feeling. It's not a feeling, right? But I think of it as being a feeling. I take a universal cover of this feeling. Since the n is simply connected, I have a bunch of copies of lambda, as many copies of lambda as I had elements in pi 1 of the thing, right? But I know that the point maps to the fundamental class of each one of those, right? So it means that I only have one copy of the thing, right? That's the proof of theorem. Okay. That's clear? Or maybe not, or I don't know. It's obvious. Maybe it's obvious. Okay.
Was it obvious you had to use twisted coefficients, or did you?
Was it obvious that I have to use twisted? Yeah. I mean, I cannot extract this information out of just the sequence without twisted coefficient, because it only knows something about this, and not about the universal cover. And somehow I want H0. I want the universal cover to have only one sheet, and that's so I need to twist coefficient somewhere. Yes, and also, I mean, because this is always true, I mean, and this is not always true, and I had an extra condition to have this theorem. So, for instance, I tell you that we have a counterexample when we don't assume the uniqueness of this augmentation. So, if I just start with the Legendrian trefoil, right? You know that this thing is fillable by a torus, right? And now I will spin this filling, right? And I will get a filling of a Legendrian torus in R5, right? And it is fillable by S1 times a puncture torus, right? So it's still, this is not something simply connected, but I have this loop. This circle of cusp facing each other. So on this circle of cusp, I will attach a two handle to have two parallel layers and something like that. So I make a surgery on this thing. And what it gives me on the top, well, it gives me a torus where I attach a two handle. So this here is a Legendrian sphere, right? So this is a Legendrian sphere which is fillable by something. So if I just remove a little bit of a point here, I can see it as being a cobordism from the witness sphere to a Legendrian sphere, right? But this is non-simply connected because I think I didn't kill this cycle, right? So this is a counterexample. So what it tells you that my proof doesn't work. So it tells you that like this chord, which I make appearing by making this cobordism, is absolutely essential and it exists in homology and it survives in any other. Okay. And now, how do we prove theorem B? Well, we will try to prove it. Attempt to prove theorem B. So maybe I need to tell you what was theorem B. Theorem B was I had an ondo cobordism, so cobordism from lambda to itself, and there is an augmentation of lambda over C. Okay, not only over Z2. Right. So far we won't see why I do need C and why it doesn't work over Z2, but it will be when I move from attempt to actual proof that you will see what's going on. And I also assume that pi 1 of lambda is 1, and I want to prove that pi 1 of sigma is 1. So the remark is that since pi 1 of lambda is 1, we have that pi 1 of sigma is equal to 1 if and only if h1 of sigma tilde relative to its negative n is 0. Okay, that's okay, right? So it means that, again, I will need to leave the coefficient to have information about h1 of something, but I will play with the second exact sequence, I hope I did not erase it, which is this one, right? Right. So the exact sequence, so the first exact sequence, since I forgot to give him a name, with twisted coefficients give you something like this. So all those terms are cohomology now, right? But now I have like this twisted augmentation which arise. And here I have the homology of sigma tilde relative to its negative n, right? And basically I want to show that h1 of this is 0, right? So if the cardinality of pi 1 of sigma is finite, then somehow I won, right? Because what I wanted, what I will do, I will prove that h1 of this is 0 by proving that the dimension of h1 of this is 0. And this has a dimension because this is finitely generated by, because I assume that pi 1 was finite, right? So I will define sigma tilde n to be a cover of sigma n. So what is sigma n? I have a cobordism which starts from something to itself, and I glue it together, right? And sigma tilde n is a pi 1 equivariant gluing of sigma tilde right? So it's not the universal cover of sigma n, right? Because then it would change the automorphism group. So this is sigma tilde n is still a cover of sigma n, which have the same Degg transformation group, okay? And I play with this exact sequence. And here I have sigma tilde n, right? And assume that h1 of sigma tilde, d sigma tilde, is non-zero, then the rank, just playing with Meyer-Vietoris, I think, the rank of h1 sigma n del sigma n goes to infinity, right? But this is generated by Rebcord times generator of the fundamental group and Rebcord times element of the fundamental group. So it will mean that it will also have a dimension which is smaller than twice the number of Rebcord times the cardinality of pi 1, and that's a contradiction, right? So far what I prove is that either the fundamental group is trivial or it has infinite cardinality. But when it has infinite cardinality, I cannot run this argument. And this is where something I think is very cool is coming. Maybe it was cool because we didn't know it, but maybe you all know it, but like we were stuck and we discover something called L2 homology. So maybe you all know L2 homology or no? Okay. Right? So L2 homology deals actually with this type of problem where you have some, so it's Atiya who made it and he wanted something like a Gauss-Bonnet formula, so an Euler characteristic for some non-compact manifold which have a co-compact isometric group, right? And it defines something like that, right? So this is something which exists quite a long time, well, for a while, but I don't know, we didn't know it, and it actually really solved our problem. So I want slightly to explain it a little bit. So I have my group, And now you can assume that it is infinite because when it's finite, it's solved. And what is the group ring of pi? So it's just the set of functions from pi to c, which are almost everywhere zero. Right, this is what the group ring is, and somehow it is quite a bad thing, or it doesn't have decomposition, it's not an Hilbert space or something like that, so I will make it an Hilbert space. And how do I make it an Hilbert space? I just take L2 of pi, and as the set of functions from pi to c, which are square summable. Right, and I want this to be my object of rank 1. Okay. So what is an object of rank? N? Well, it will just be taking this ring, tensor Cn, right? And this, I want it to be my object of rank N, okay? And the object I will actually consider are closed continuous subspace of this, and so, which are pi equivariant. So this is an Hilbert space with a pi action, and I want this to be pi equivariant. And this object, I call it a finitely generated Hilbert pi module. And I want to make sense of the dimension of such an object, right? So what I can do, since this is a closed subspace, I can project to it, right? And I can include it back. And I have a map from this to this, which is the composition of the projection and the inclusion, which I call F. And if I were in a finite dimensional vector space, the trace of this map will exactly be the dimension of W, right? So I'm defining the L2 rank of W to be the pi equivariant pi part of the trace, so it is the sum from I is equal to 1 to n of f of 1 tensor ei, 1 tensor ei. Okay, so I take this trace and I call it the L2 rank of W. Right, be careful, this is a real number. But it enjoys a lot of property. Which are useful. Okay, so a bunch of facts. The rank of something is zero if and only if the something is zero. So this is a good property if I want to run the proof I made, because in the end I want to have something which has rank zero, and I did, right? I also want to be able to have this type of bounds, right? So this type of bounds come from the following thing. If I have a weak exact sequence, so weak exact means that not the image of I is the kernel of P, but more the closure of the image of I is equal to the kernel of P, then the rank of this is the sum of the rank of things in between. Right. What I don't have for free is the snake lemma. So those are somehow facts, which are somehow easy to check. What is not so easy to check, but it is a theorem of Shiger and Gromov. Is the following thing, is that if you have three complexes, of course, if I have like a complex of Hilbert pi module, what I want to call is L2 homology of the complex is the kernel of D modulo the closure of the image of D. Right. So the thing is, and I think that's the reason why some people didn't use it before, is that this makes the thing really vanish. right? It vanishes much more than the usual homology, right? So it is more often zero than you want. So if you want actually information out of the fact that the homology is non-vanishing, like number of periodic orbits or something like that, this is might not be such a good tool. It is a very good tool for us because we want something to vanish. Okay. So now if you have an exact sequence of complex like this, and C, C prime, and C prime prime are freely finitely generated, right? So which means that the underlying complex are vector space of this form, right? Then you have a snake lemma. There is a long exact sequence in L2 cohomology. Right? But everything I had was free, freely generated, because it was generated by Ripcord, and then I had this action of pi 1, and it is finitely generated because I'm in R2n plus 1. So I still have the long exact sequence I described you in L2 cohomology, right? So I can still run this argument. And you can run the Meyer-Vietoris exact sequence also because you have a cellular presentation of the thing, which is free, freely generated. And so you also have, like when you stack cobordism all together, the rank will explode, and you have the contradiction. And so this allows to run the same argument and conclude that H1 of sigma tilde del minus sigma tilde is zero. And this, the L2 cohomology, and this, if you play with Meyer-Vietoris, it implies that pi 1 of sigma tilde is equal to 1. Okay? So this prove also, well, this run out the case that, I mean, it's a we assume that it was infinite to make all the theory, and we arrive at the point that it was finite, but very finite, but that's, that proved the theorem B, right? Okay. So those were the two applications of the twisted coefficient I wanted to tell you, and I think I still have a little bit of time, right?
So yeah,
so
so
yeah, yeah.
Is that self-joint here, or?
Hmm? F is what?
Self-adjoint.
Is this a positive number? Yeah, it is a positive number, right? Because you have this, like pi is the adjoint of I, right? It's the P is a projection, right? So this is indeed always, this is something positive. That's what you ask?
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Wait, what?
Wait, pi is, this is equal to pi, right? This is a positive operator.
Oh.
Yeah. This is why this is true. Right. Okay, so maybe, yeah. I don't have so many more things to say, but maybe I go back to Egor's question about where did I use the negative end of the cobordism was simply connected. So because maybe you didn't see it, right? So this is a subtle point, and I was planning on sweep it under the carpet if I had no time, but it turned that I have some time, so I want to explain it, right? So where did I use it? Well, I use it in the very first step when I was lifting the coefficient. So where pi 1 of lambda is used, right? And why basically the proof I've made doesn't work for this thing, right? because I gave you a counterexample of the theorem, right? So it's when lifting coefficients, right? So I had this situation, right? And on the red part, which is not red, right? I use an augmentation. But I use an augmentation, actually, we use an augmentation of the Chekhanov algebra of lambda minus into, here I use it into Z2 for the white part. But for the red part, I need to use an augmentation into pi 1, into Z2, pi 1 of sigma. And here I need to twist the coefficient with pi 1 of lambda, right? So that everything makes sense, because when I break, I need to keep track. So basically, like the existence of this doesn't guarantee me the existence of this, right? Unless the image of pi 1 of lambda in pi 1 of sigma is trivial or something like that, right? And even though, like, augmentation in this ring are not obvious, and for instance, and then I will stop here, right? In this knot, if in this torus, if you look, you have, like, okay, it has an S1 family of repcord, but I make a small perturbation so that I make a maximum here and a minimum here. And what is the twisted differential? You have the boundary of gamma m is 1 plus the longitude times gamma m, I think, and this goes to, well, I'm not so sure about this, I think. Okay, but the point is that this curve goes to 1 plus mu, right? And so I cannot have an augmentation into Z2 of T2, right? Because it will have to make this mu is equal to 1, and it would have to be a ring map, right? So there is no augmentation in this thing, and this particular mu, which is this, survive in the cobordism. So, I mean, you could eventually relax a little bit the hypothesis of the theorem, saying that there exists an augmentation in the group ring. I just, for simplicity, state the fact that it was simply connected, so it means that an augmentation in the ring makes an augmentation in the group ring, okay? So this is where it was used. It was used even to define the twisted coefficient. You need to be able to lift augmentation to stuff. Okay. I think is zero, yes. Yes. If you look at either this proof or the other proof when you stack stuff, right, somehow you can relax a little bit the hypothesis you give by making uncheckable hypothesis. So for instance, like to be able to make this pi equivariant stacking of the something, you need to assume that the image of pi 1 on the left is the same as the image of pi 1 of the right. I mean, this is true when both groups are trivial, but when they are not, even if they were isomorphic but non-trivial, they could include differently, and you will not be able to make this gluing equivariant, and so you will not be able to run the argument. So like every time, I mean, if you happen to see a cobordism where you know this for a fact, then you can run the same argument and you have the theorem, but I mean, I don't know if it's checkable or not. I think I will stop here, and thanks for your attention.